ओके सो आई विल स्टार्ट. वेलकम एवरीवन टू वीक 3 प्रेयर्स एंड मेडिटेशंस बैच 6. सो वी विल जस्ट शेयर द स्क्रीन. आई विल शेयर द स्क्रीन फॉर द प्रेयर्स. सो दिस वीक टुडे वी हैड 2 प्रेयर्स टू कंटेम्पलेट अपॉन. वन वाज डिसेंबर 13 1913 एंड द अदर डिसेंबर 29 1913. सो लेट अस स्टार्ट विद this one first, December 13, and whoever wants to go first, share reflections. I'm sure we have had enough time to reflect upon the prayer. Please read the prayer first and then we can one by one unmute and share the reflections. Whoever feels ready.
I'll go, Monica.
Yes. Yes, please.
Yeah. December 13, 1913. Give me thy light, O Lord. Grant that I do not fall into any error. Grant that the infinite reverence, the utter devotion, that intense and profound love I bring to thee may be radiant, convincing, contagious, and be awakened in every heart. O Lord, eternal Master, thou art my light and my peace. Guide my steps, open my eyes, illumine my heart, and lead me on the paths that go straight to thee. O Lord, Lord, grant that I may have no other will than thine, and that all my acts may be an expression of thy divine love. A great light floods my whole being, and I am no longer conscious of anything but thee. Peace, peace, peace upon all the earth. Yes, when I read this prayer, no? Yeah, first line itself, it's always my prayer actually. I do not fall into any error or falsehood. Yes, that is a very important prayer. And next line, grant that the infinite reverence, the utter devotion, that intense and profound love. Yes, Mother is really bringing that to everyone, to all human beings who all open to her, I feel actually. Because in this yoga, Sri Aurobindo always insisted upon, after the mother's coming, open yourself to mother. So I think this is the thing that actually connected with that phrase of Sri Aurobindo, because she invoked that love, profound love, which is radiant, convincing, contagious, and be awakened in every heart. So it is really a collective yoga. So that I felt when I read this thing, actually. This is a collective yoga. She is invoking that love, profound love and devotion in every heart. So that is the mantra. If you open to mother, definitely this will be taken forward, actually. And next line. O Lord, eternal Master, thou art my light and my peace, guide my steps, open my eyes, illumine my heart. Yeah, this is also a very, Mother always used to mention these things in her prayer always, and lead me on the paths that grow straight to thee. And next also, she is invoking that, O Lord, grant that I may have no other will than thine, and that all my acts may be an expression of thy divine law. I feel that only she can do that. Actually, expression of thy divine law as human beings. Yeah, only she can do that. And we have to open to her, that's all. And the next is, a great light floods my whole being, and I am no longer conscious of anything but thee. This line again reminded me actually one of the prayer of Kabbali Shastriya, who was an early sadhak in ashram. He used to see a column of light in mother always, that white light. Even he wrote a book in that caption, Flame of White Light. This line reminded me of his prayer actually. He used to tell whenever mother used to walk on the terrace, it seems, Kabbali Shastriya used to see mother, and whenever he sees mother, he feels this light, only that column of light he sees in the mother. So this line reminded me of that prayer. Then peace, peace upon all the earth. Yes, this is always mother. Yeah, she used to invoke that peace for the whole of the earth. Yeah, this is my take. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you so much, Chitra ji. Wonderful. Yeah, anyone who wants to share next? Dr. Rashmi, Rakhi, Shweta, anyone who is ready? Yes, Shweta.
So the first paragraph is so profound, and it really, you know, like resonates with my heart. It's almost like, you know, it's our prayer. All of us want this. Give thy light, O Lord. Grant that I do not fall into any error. Grant that the infinite reverence, the utter devotion, that intense and profound love I bring to thee may be radiant, convincing, contagious, and be awakened in every heart. Yeah, this is what, you know, this is our daily prayer. This is my daily prayer. But also, you know, like as I go forward, I understand that, you know, there's a lot, this path is, you know, it's just started, and there's so much of purification needed that, as I go through this prayer, you know, especially the second last paragraph, O Lord, grant that I may have no other will than thine, and that all my acts may be an expression of thy divine law. And I love this, you know, this sentence, and yet I know that, you know, a long way to go, so much work to be done to reach this place, you know. And the last paragraph, a great light floods my whole being, and I'm no longer conscious of anything but thee. Yeah, this also, I think, a long way to reach. And peace, peace, peace upon all the earth. This really touched my heart, because last 3 days I am feeling so troubled, you know, listening to Afghanistan ka news and Taliban ka. It really feels as if, you know, oh God, please help them. Let peace be there upon earth, really. So I could resonate to that, and, you know, this is what I felt.
Yeah, beautiful. Thank you so much. I think it's really beautiful if a prayer for everyone can arise in our being. It's really divine grace if that happens. Because usually our focus is so much narcissist, you know, we're always troubled by our own troubles. And it's really grace if we can pray not only for our own peace, but also for the whole of us, all of us. Yeah. Yeah. Anyone who wants to share next? Yeah, Rakhi ji, Rashmi. Yeah, yes, Rakhi.
Beautiful prayer. And I've been constantly, I mean, I was listening to Shweta, I was listening to Chitra ji, and, you know, still continuously reading, you know, what is written. And, you know, I feel that, you know, a little part of this prayer also, if I'm able to imbibe in myself and start living it, in my, you know, day-to-day life, I don't know where I'll reach, is what I feel. You know, simple words, yet with beautiful meaning. And I mean, that's what I feel, you know. I again agree with Shweta saying that peace upon all earth, the way things are going now and the news that is being spreading and we are listening to it, it is, it's very sad. So may Lord grant the peace on this earth. This is what I think.
Yeah, Rakhi, as you beautifully shared that even if one line I can imbibe in my life, so would you like to share any one or two lines in this prayer which really kind of...
Especially this second paragraph, O Lord, Eternal Master, Thou art my light and my peace, guide my steps, open my eyes, illumine my heart, and lead me on the paths that go straight to thee. I would, you know, I mean, that is something that constantly goes into my mind, you know. Wherever I feel so confused, I mean, the first thing I do, please guide me. You know, if I'm feeling so restless, something is not okay. Please open my eyes. May I not be, you know, prejudiced, or may I not be, you know, assuming things about people or my own self, or may I not be judgy about others. So please open my eyes, illumine my heart. So this is something I really, really, you know, relate.
This yeah, beautiful. Yeah, beautiful. Thank you so much.
Yeah, Dr. Monica, namaskar.
Yes, sir, Rashmiji, please, yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, actually, as I read these lines, I am filled with, you know, myself with peace. So, the first line says that, grant that I do not fall into any error. It reminds me of that, itni sakti hame dena data, ki bhul kar bhi bhul na ho. This is this kind of prayer. And when I go through all this, I feel at what level of consciousness Mother might have reached at that time. And she's, I had read somewhere that Sri Aurobindo said that Mother praying from her lower self to her higher self in all these prayers. So at what consciousness she must have, you know, written this prayer. It is so profound. And, you know, to get that infinite reverence, that devotion, which is utter, means it is that bhakti, which is unmixed with any other thing, utter devotion. That intense and profound love, what I bring to thee, it should be radiant, it should be convincing, and it should be contagious. So what level of our sadhana we should reach so that we get all these, and we should pray for every being on earth that it should be awakened in every heart. And when I can reach to that stage, that he remains, or he or she remains my sole focus, so that I do not commit any error. Because we are living a life where errors, mistakes are bound to happen. But they will not happen when I am completely, you know, completely focused in her, in all my work. And I'm completely, you know, whatever I do becomes an expression of his will and his law or her law. So she is showing us the path, actually. And she has reached that level where, no, that ecstasy she has reached with all acquiring all this, that a light, a great light floods her whole being. and she is not there, but only he or she. This is very profound. This shows us the way. Thank you.
Thank you, Rashmiji. Yeah, beautiful.
I want to add, Dr. Rashmiji ne jab wo, you know, that itni shakti hame dena data, my eyes just lit up, you know. The old memory when my kids were small and we used to, you know, make them sleep raat ko. So this prayer, itni shakti hame dena data bhajan, this song and Om Purvasa, I mean, these were two things we would definitely do it with them, and only then they would sleep. So, but then, you know, the whole rush, the running around, and it just kind of stopped. So when I just heard that, I felt, you know, that such a beautiful thing was happening and it just stopped. So I think this, thank you, Dr. Rashmiji, this might start again with me, because I really, really you know, love that song. And I just relate to that so much.
Because it is an affirmation, some sort of.
Yes.
Yeah, really beautiful. Yes. Yeah, so Kuldeep ji, would you like to share anything? Do you have any reflection to share?
Monica ji.
Yeah.
अभी तो सारे मैकेनिकल प्रोसेस ही कर रहा हूँ. ये जो थॉट के आधार पे थॉट को कंट्रोल करना, ये सब चीजें हेल्पफुल है, लेकिन अभी मैं इन सब को रिकंसिडर कर रहा हूँ. मतलब कभी मतलब प्रेयर को या फिर ये वर्बल जो ऑटो सजेशन को इतना महत्व कभी नहीं दिया, लेकिन अभी देख रहा हूँ कि लाइफ में जब चीजें काम नहीं कर रही तो ये सबको मतलब मैं मतलब इन सबको मौका दे रहा हूँ. ये थोड़ा थोड़ा हाई लेवल का प्रेयर लगा मुझे, लेकिन ये सबसे लेकिन सबसे सिंपल प्रेयर भी है ये. मतलब रादर देन मतलब एक जहाँ मदर थी कि गलती से भी गलती ना हो. हाँ, मतलब मेरे विचारों में भी गलती नहीं हो ऐसा. मतलब ग्रांड में आई डू नॉट फॉल इन टू एनी एरर. तो उनका है कि इवन माई थॉट्स माई इमोशंस ये भी मतलब लाइन पे रहे. मतलब इनमें भी भाव रहे. इनफिनाइट रेवरेंस, अटर डिवोशन, इंटेंस एंड प्रोफाउंड लव. मतलब जो हम जिस लेवल का लव और डिवोशन और रेवरेंस होता है, तो उसके साथ ये सुपरलेटिव मतलब the kind of मतलब हाइट्स पे उसको लेके गए. मतलब
जी बिल्कुल. Hello? जी जी बिल्कुल. या थैंक यू सो मच फॉर शेयरिंग. सो लेट अस गो ओवर अगेन वंस मोर. आई विल जस्ट गो थ्रू द प्रेयर वंस अगेन एंड वी विल सी इफ देयर इज मोर. And in case you have more insights in between, do add and unmute and share. Give me thy light, O Lord. Grant that I do not fall into any error. And I think as Rashmiji was sharing that this is mother in the lower consciousness praying to the higher self, and all is mother, all is the play of mother only, play of mother, leela of mother. But it's the mother in lower consciousness praying to the higher consciousness. That's what we do when we pray, that we pray to something higher than me, which we know is not separate than me, but of which I am not really conscious of. That's why we call it our higher self, our inner truth, which is, it's like important for me to know that what I see, what I am conscious of is only the tip of the iceberg, which I call as myself. And if I only remain conscious of that tip of iceberg, then I will always remain miserable because I don't even know who I am truly. So it's very important that this prayer rises through our own pain, through our own conflicts, challenges, and suffering. Only then a true prayer rises, such beings we are, that a true prayer only rises when we go through challenges and pain, where we realize that our little limited consciousness is not really enough to give us the happiness that we seek. And that's why a realization of who we truly are becomes a necessity for us if we really want to have a fulfilled and content life. So this is our lower half, lower consciousness, which is usually identified with the thoughts, with the feelings as myself, and not really aware of any beyond in myself, praying to something higher, something more than me, to shed greater light, to give me or open my eyes to illumination. Yeah. And this is what we call as sattvic ego. So there are three qualities of ego: the tamasic ego, the rajasic, and the sattvic ego. In the tamasic ego, I think I have shared many a times, but let me just shortly discuss here. I think it's aligned with what we are talking. In tamasic, I don't even admit that there is a lack. Yeah, so there is a lot of inertia. It's just a material life that I live. In the rajasic ego, there is an admission of a lack, but I want to fulfill that lack through things and people and situations and consumerism of all sorts. I would consume thoughts. I would consume social media so as to fulfill that lack. Yeah, so consumption-based, bhog-based is the rajasic part. And I think we all fall into these phases here and there. It's like we keep on fluctuating. And then comes the sattvic ego, which we know as a receptive ego, which we understand that, yes, there is a lack, and only a guru or a master or words full of light and illumination can help me understand that lack and maybe shatter the wall of ignorance that exists in me. So there is a greater admission of ignorance. One is humble, one is grounded, and one also seeks for clarity, whether from within or from without. It does not matter. Since we are all walking each other home, it doesn't matter. We require the help of each other on this way. And then we have the Trishul of Shiva, you know, where with his Trishul, he goes beyond the sattvic, rajasic, and tamasic ego. So it's not that I have to remain stationed in the sattvic ego all the time, always seeking, seeking, seeking. No, there is something beyond all these states of ego also. So the sattvic is only the ladder which I need to use so that I touch something beyond all these states of consciousness, states of ego. Yeah. And with Shiva, with his Trishul, kills, as if destroys the ladder also. Once you have reached the terrace, which every moment we have to reach the terrace, it's not that once in my lifetime I reach the terrace and then there is no reversal. Not like that. Every moment the terrace has to be reached. And what I mean by terrace is the consciousness which is the highest possible in that moment. Yeah. What is my highest possibility in this moment? That is where I go beyond even the sattvic ego. Yeah. So, and that is what we call at the Shiva consciousness, which is beyond all these fleeting stages of ego consciousness. So this is what is the prayer. I would feel that it is as if the prayer is rising up towards, take me through all these steps to the consciousness of beyond, you know, who I truly am. Not my limited awareness, limited consciousness, but what I truly am. What are my infinite possibilities each moment? Give me thy light, O Lord. Grant that I do not fall into any error. Now, what is our biggest error? Our biggest error is falling into the trap of ego consciousness. My biggest error each moment is identifying myself as the thought, identifying myself as the story in the head, identifying myself as the feeling or sense perception. The more and tightly I identify myself as that this is me, the thought is me, the desire is me, the ambition is me, the greed is me, the lust is me. The more I identify myself as that, the more I suffer. So my suffering is a signal that I have fallen into the error, and the error being identifying myself with the surface consciousness or the ego consciousness. Yeah. So in that sense, suffering would come as a signal that, hey, again, I have fallen into the trap. And this can happen each moment, no matter how beautiful a peaceful experience I may have the previous moment. In the next moment, something or the other may happen, which may again trap me into the ego consciousness. So the journey is really long and arduous. Yeah. This is the error that we have to be cautious of, vigilant of. Grant that the infinite reverence, the utter devotion, and that intense and profound love I bring to thee may be radiant, convincing, contagious, and be awakened in every heart. So this is our individual journey, that the more purify, I think someone was also touching upon purification, a beautiful aspect which almost goes on throughout our life, the aspect of purification. The more purified, the more refined, the more intense I become in my devotion, in my giving myself to the higher intelligence or to the divine, that becomes contagious by its side effect. It's not that I want it to be contagious. By its side effect, it becomes contagious. The more pure I become in my own being. And that's how Mother says, be like a flower. So the more pure, like a flower, full of fragrance, I become only for my own self, that's the contribution I give to the world, that I am one drop of poison less in that little moment. Yeah. And many of us were concerned about what is happening in the world. I think when we see these kind of things happening, almost a sense of urgency, with a sense of urgency that if we do not awake to ourselves, if we do not wake up to who we truly are, these things will remain in existence. Wars, torture, violence, unless we stop the violence on my own self. So what I see outside is just a reflection of the violence I do to my own self. And whenever I am identified to the ego consciousness, it's a violence to the self. It's a torture to the self. Whenever I think that this desire is my desire and must be fulfilled, it's a torture. Whenever I feel that this expectation is my expectation and must be fulfilled, again a torture on myself. So we really need a detachment from the surface consciousness. We need to live in our depths. We need to know more of what is available rather than the tip of the iceberg, whatever is below the waters, whatever is in the depths of our being. We need to more and more identify ourselves as that inner silence, inner quiet, which in effect is, it's not a passive inner quiet, which is very, very active. It is very intelligent. So the more I identify with this inner quiet and stillness, the more I get to know where I need to act, and the more I also get to know where I do not need to act. So that is what we call as discernment, you know, the right action. It's not that I will become passive, everything is taken care of by the divine, so why do I need to care? That is actually hypocrisy. That means we have not touched truly our inner self. Because when we truly are in touch with our inner self, then right action takes place effortlessly. It's a choiceless right action taking place. You just know that this should be done in this moment. Yeah, it's a very direct action that takes place with force. But it's not an aggressive force. Yeah? Just like ego is very aggressive in nature. It's not that kind of aggressiveness. It's just a very direct, pinpointed effort. So that's where we can understand the difference between a passive kind of a surrender where all is taken care of by the divine. So why do I need to bother? You know, you have become dull in your being. Not like that. It creates a lot of efficiency in the being if we are truly connected with the inner self. O Lord, eternal master, thou art my light. Now this is beautiful line, phrase. Thou art my light. What is the light that sees through my eyes? What is the light that sees through my ears? That listens through my ears? What is the light that understands through my intelligence? What is beyond my intelligence? What is giving power to my intelligence? What is giving power to my body movements? That is the light. Without that, I am a grain of sand. I am unconscious, unawake. But with that, I am alive. So this light of consciousness, this which is beyond or beneath all our actions, non-actions, 24/7 with us. And we take it so much of granted that we don't even have to pay attention to it. Yeah, we only pay attention to it when we suffer. That, oh my God, something really is not okay. What really happened? So we become aware of our own true self, this light of consciousness, which really does not bother for our attention to it, which is active. Passively, it is active throughout. That light is the infinite consciousness of divinity. And that's why we can say we are all one. Just like space is all one. It's all one. You know, you cannot say this is the space which belongs to India. That is the space which belongs to Pakistan. No, space does not have divisions. Only boundaries have divisions. Only forms have division. And just like that, this light of consciousness is all pervading like space. That does not divide. And that's why if something happens in Pakistan, it affects me. If something happens in Afghanistan, it affects me. Because we are all connected. It must affect me. Because only then I would be able to take a stand and be sensitive to what is happening in the world. If it stops to affect me, then I've become like a stone. Yeah, then what is the point of being human? So it's beautiful to keep this sensitivity alive, because this sensitivity allows me to take the right action, to be alive. Thou art my light, my peace. Guide my steps. Again, you know, a reference to the sattvic kind of consciousness, that I am understanding that how flawed I am, how full of weaknesses I am, and I need higher force, I need guiding light. So where we come on our knees, this is the start of our journey, where I realize that I do not really know my own self. I do not really know what is the right action for me and the others. This is the start of our sadhana. Guide my steps, because an arrogant ego cannot say guide my steps. You know, in our arrogance, we say, I know. No, I know what is the best for me. It's only when we fall to ground, when we shatter ourselves through the blows of life, only then we realize that, oh my God, I really don't know. I may have read too much, but that's really not helping me. Please open me to your light. I need higher light. That's where the intensity of prayer rises up. So it's beautiful to shatter. It's beautiful to break apart, because all that can break apart is the ego. Yeah. So it's beautiful to shatter and break apart. Guide my steps. Open my eyes. So you are realizing, I'm realizing that my eyes were not really open, because I was not able to see really clearly what is good for me and for the other. Illumine my heart. How constricted we have become in my heart, in our hearts. So illumine my heart. Make it full of light, peace and love. And lead me on the paths that goes straight to thee. And when I say thee, parallelly, I can use the words peace, love, stillness, clarity, knowledge, oneness. All these are synonyms for the divine, vastness. Yeah. So illumine my being in such a way that I go straight to this vastness, suppleness, flexibility, openness, love. You know, love is what we need in the world most, you know, most. So if I become love myself, then wherever I go, I exude love. That's what we need in the world most. We don't need more engineers, we don't need more money. All that we seek and crave for, we are thirsty for love. So can more of us become full of love? And we can only become full of love when we really know our truth, because our truth is love. That thing below the iceberg, the tip of the iceberg, that's why it's necessary to know that being, because that is the being of love that I am truly. If I don't know it, then I'll always be a beggar. And there are enough beggars in the world. So can we have more kings who exude out their treasures, you know, who give out their treasures, who give out their little joys of life? O Lord, Lord, grant that I may have no other will than thine, and that all my acts may be an expression of thy divine law. So a clarity, a vigilance to recognize that little trivial wills that we have, you know, expectations from this person, that person, they may be there, you know, we can keep them there, but not give them too much of importance. Yeah, my desires are not completely vanished. My expectations are not really gone, but I don't give them too much of importance. Yeah, they can just lie in my room like a spider in the corner. It doesn't bother me, you know. So can it be like that? That it's not that my desires or the ripples are completely gone. I still have expectations from people, but I don't give them so much of importance that I vanquish my love just because my expectations are not met. So we begin to take ourselves less seriously. You know, we don't give ourselves much importance, so-called ourselves, you know, these surface movements. Yeah, it's okay. I have unfulfilled desires. So what? I can still be loved. Yeah, I still have expectations from people. So what? I can still be loved. Yeah, so then something really transformational can happen. And then we can be sure that in that moment where I'm not giving much importance to my own agendas and manipulations, I am following the divine will. I am one with the flow of the divine, which is 24/7 present. It's only when I become a stumbling block, you know, on the in between the flow, I try to become a stumbling block, only then problems happen. So when I see the ripples of expectations and demands and still do not give them much importance, then I am not becoming a block in the divine flow of love. A great light floods my whole being, and this has to be our practical experience. Yeah. And once we have tasted one experience, Mother says, relive that experience. Once you have tasted fullness of the being, only once, even once if you have tasted it, relive that experience or that fullness whenever you need that fullness. And whenever you feel that you are getting into the trap of ego consciousness again, relive that fullness again. That yes, if it's possible for me once, it can be possible for me again. That fulfilled being, the contentment in the being. Yeah. And this actually can be done as a visualization while you go to sleep, while we wake up in the morning, or whenever we have moments to ourselves, that a great light is flooding my being, which is fulfillment itself. Nothing else is needed. And I am no longer conscious of anything but thee. So no longer conscious of any little trivialities of life, but that fullness filling up my being. And now whenever I'm acting in the world, I'll be acting through that fullness. Since I do not demand anything from my relationships now, I can be more giving in my relationships, because I am connected to the source, which is all omnipotent, omnipowerful source, you know, which is fulfilling my being. So imagine that you are a container, little container, and now you have a direct touch with the Ganges, the flow of Ganges. Now, why do I need to get from others? Yeah, I may still receive from others, and I'll take it with all utter humility and gratitude. But now I'll not be begging, since I'm connected to that divine flow. Yeah, so the begging goes to bonkers. Now the begging is not needed. So I'm no longer conscious of anything but thee. And in only this way, only when we connect ourselves to the source of everything, peace can be there on earth. Yeah, because then I am one drop of begging and poison less in this world. So my being becomes a being of peace and love. That's what we need most in this world. Yeah. So any more reflections? Anything more?
Dr. Monica, Rashmi here.
Yes, Rashmiji.
Yeah, it occurred to me, if and when in our journey we are guided by the grace and we get our path also, but what happens because we are in samsara, something happens, maybe you can throw some light on that. We get distracted even though we clearly see the path. This is the grand trunk road shown to me by the mother and Sri Aurobindo. But still, something happens till I get that jolt to come back to it, come back to the path. Does it happen because something inside me, still, impure?
Beautiful, yeah.
So I request you to throw some light.
Yes.
So why, because we have seen that grand trunk road.
Yeah.
Because life's lot of jolts, it happens because once we are open, the things actually, the grace acts in that way to take towards heart. But again, it's because of our lower nature, we again get distracted.
Absolutely. It's because of our lower nature that we still get distracted. And I think we must get distracted. We don't have to stop ourselves from getting distracted. We have to go through the distraction. Because if I try to control myself, in ascetic way, if I try to imagine that I am attracted to some or other kind of addiction. Imagine, okay? Now, there is this strong attraction to that addiction in me. But all that I am trying to do is I am trying to suppress that addiction. That no, I should not be going there. I should not be going there, or I should not be doing that. Yeah? So what will happen is I'll not be progressing in my life. When we plunge into the challenge, when we plunge into the distraction, yeah, and really, one has to realize that there is no destination but divine. For all of us, each one of us, even for a terrorist or a criminal, the destination is divine. There is no other end point that we all of us have. Yeah. So whether I take a straight path, which is really, really rare, maybe needs a lot of lifetimes of preparation, whether I take that path or whether I do get distracted, which is most common way for each one of us, the journey is a win-win situation. You're going to end up in the divine only. Now, it's different that you will face more challenges. And I think we must face more challenges, more distractions, because that's the, as you pointed out rightly, that's the purification I need. So it's good not to suppress yourself. If you are getting attracted to a wrong thing, so-called morally, ethically wrong thing, do that. Okay, you will do it once. You will do that twice. You will do it thrice. You will do it for 1 year. Sooner or later, if your intensity of aspiration is still there, which I'm sure all of us who are on the path, the intensity remains, yeah? You will get to know and you will really be convinced that, okay, this is not the way. I have learned enough. I have had enough blows. And now enough of my learnings. Okay, get myself back to the straight path now. So I think it's very important for us to get distracted, to allow ourselves to get distracted. Because there definitely is some impurity which is remaining in us, which requires purification. And if I do not allow myself to plunge into the challenge and to keep on suppressing it, I will also be avoiding the progress that I need to make through that challenge. So, yeah, I think that's what is coming at the moment.
Thank you.
Would it make any sense for you, what you were asking?
Yeah, it makes sense for sure. It starts with the mind. Then once mind is, it is settled in the mind, then vital also reacts. Then once it is settled in the vital, then all of a sudden physical also, comes in the picture and makes you take the blow actually.
Take the blow. I think take the blow. They are blows of Mahakali. Just take the blow. Take the blow, make the necessary. Mother says, just if you have the right attitude, right? If we have the right attitude, and what is the right attitude? That no matter what the situation is, I will learn. I will progress. So even if I go into the hell for a moment, and if I have the right attitude that even if I'm pulled towards the hell, I'm pulled towards this attraction or distraction, what you call it. If I have even a streak of a attitude that I'm going to learn through this journey, what is the lesson for me here? I think no one can stop you from making the right progress. We need to go into the plunges of our darkness. We cannot keep on avoiding it. Only then we can clean those hell or the dark kind of patches in us. And those are the patches in us which require purification. The light parts in us do not require much purification. They are very enlightened. But the dark parts, which again and again get distracted, they are the ones craving for purification. And if I keep on suppressing them, if I tell that, okay, I'm on the path now, everything is pure and hunky and dory, then it does not do me any good. So I have to recognize that the weaknesses are still there. They pull me towards these and these. Okay, let me go through this and I will learn my lesson. So if the right attitude is there, even in the hell, you will find the treasure. Definitely.
Yeah, it's fantastic.
And if we keep on avoiding the hell, then we also keep on avoiding our progress. That also we have to keep in mind, that if we want to progress in this, on this path of sadhana, or even in general in life, if we want to progress, we have to touch our darker parts. We cannot keep on suppressing it. We cannot keep on suppressing it for the fact that what will people think about me, or what will, I think about myself, that, oh my God, I'm so distracted. Okay, yes, you are distracted. So let us face it. Let us face it and go through the distraction.
Just one thought, actually.
Yeah, please.
What comes to my mind immediately, in that case, are we not actually putting more shackles on our feet? Number one. Number two, whether in those moments of distraction, this prayer, this kind of prayer can help me to take me out, or to help me to transform that part of the lower nature, instead of putting more shackles.
Sudhav, imagine, Rashmiji, that you are in a sea, ocean, and you are jumping from one boat, which is a very dilapidated boat. It's going to maybe really sink very soon. And the other boat is the divine boat, the boat of divine consciousness, where although you see light that, yes, this boat can save me, but you're not really sure whether to really climb totally into that boat or not. So what happens with us, and why we suffer really again and again, confusion and doubt, because half of my leg, or one of my leg, is in the older boat, which is the boat of lower consciousness, which actually gives me pleasure at times. You know, it's not that I completely want to let go of it. Yeah. While I also see that it's a sinking boat and I want to raise my other leg to the divine boat. Now, half of my leg is in the divine boat and I see that light, I see that purity. I am convinced that it is beautiful. And the other leg also tastes the pleasure of lower consciousness and the pains of lower consciousness also. Now, how would you be if you are in an ocean and world is called a bhavsagar or an ocean, with one leg in this boat and the other leg on that boat? We will be in a very miserable condition.
Correct.
That is what happens with us mostly. So that's why it is good to, I think I'm with you when you say that in those moments where you see yourself sinking back into the trap of lower consciousness, these prayers help. And that is why we read the prayers. That's why we read the prayers or contemplate upon it so that we go upwards. We are not pulled by the lower again and again. And yet, when we are pulled by the lower, I think it is very important for us to address the lower, to understand deeply the lower, because without understanding the lower, I cannot completely transform it. I cannot shoo away the lower because it is here to stay. As long as I am alive, it is here to stay. So what is the best way then for me to overcome or transform the lower? The best way is to have the divine light, which comes through these prayers and everything, moments of prayer, intensity of prayer, to have that aspiration to plunge into the lower. I'm not saying that you enjoy the lower. No. Plunge into the lower. See for what it is. See the darkness that lies there and understand it and transform the lower with love.
Yeah.
So both of them are absolutely necessary. Because if I have a stronger light in me, then I can definitely plunge into deeper hills and transform them. But if I have a very faint light, then it's better that I do not go into that deep a darkness because I'm not yet ready. So the more readier we become, the more light we have, the more connection with divinity we have, the more ready I become to address deeper and deeper and deeper challenges. Yeah. So it's good to have those challenges. Yeah. Okay, so I think we can take up this prayer also. We have a few moments. We'll be able to do that. So let us share our reflections on this prayer. Anyone who feels ready, and let's do it with efficiency, not waiting much. Whoever feels ready, let's go over this prayer.
Yes, Monica.
Yes, please. Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, actually, you previously mentioned, this only came to my mind in this prayer. We have to acknowledge our errors and falsehoods. In the second para, my mother mentioned, may our mistakes acknowledge. And you want me to read the prayer, full prayer?
It's okay. You have started. Please continue. It's okay.
Yeah.
We'll read it at the end. We can read it at
okay.
the end.
Okay. Yeah. Because this only came to me, this only I noted down also. This is, I am very particular. May our mistakes acknowledged and rectified within us. Yes, but because that acknowledgement is a very important thing. No, only if you realize that, you can, put all your effort and surrender that also to Divine Mother to rectify it. So that I feel very important in this prayer, actually. And also, in the previous paragraph also, the illusions, bonds of attachments, illusions and weaknesses, she mentioned particularly, which are no longer any purpose in our lives, and that at every moment we must shake off the past. Yes, that is very important. We can't stay very peaceful. I have shed all the attachments, but at any time it comes back again and again. You have to reflect upon it, and again you have to surrender it. New things will come again. You have to do that. So Mother mentioned it very clearly in this. At every moment, we must shake off the past like falling dust, that it may not soil the virgin path, which at every moment also is opening before us. Again, she stressed upon that point. No, every moment. Yeah, this is my take. Yeah, thank you.
Yeah, thank you so much.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, beautiful. Yeah, anyone who wants to share next? Anything that resonated in this prayer, anything that you are taking home with yourself through this prayer?
Prayer is very beautiful, but I think for me personally, the struggle is only, you know, yes, I'm praying this, you know, so yeah, I'm like with the prayer, and you know, it resonates totally, but I need the divine help for all this. Yeah, this is the present state, you know, where a whole lot of bonds and attachments, illusions and weakness, which have no longer any purpose in our lives. So I am with all that now. And although, you know, like in very consciously in the conscious mind, I feel that, you know, so much has been taken care of, so much grace and all. But I think which the mother says, that every moment we must shake off the past like falling dust. Consciously I feel, you know, like I'm able to do, but I don't understand how subconsciously it is still there. So the work, you know, where I really need collaboration with the divine is, you know, to just help me shake off all this from the subconscious, you know, like, so that is where I am right now, the struggles, you know, so that is what I could relate to. So I pray to the divine. Yeah.
And stuff from the subconscious, you know, slowly as we turn our eye inwards to our inner movements, what all goes inside my mind, my feelings, you know, my ways of acting, behaving, the more conscious we become of those movements, slowly what happens is the stuff from subconscious or subconscious, it keeps on resurfacing so that I can become conscious of it. And I can offer it or purify it. So I think the thing that you were saying, that what about I'm conscious of what I'm conscious of, but what about the stuff in the subconscious? So this is a very organic, I believe that this is a very natural process, that the more aware I become of my own inner movements, inner ripples, you know, where I become angry, this pattern is still there. Maybe I don't really want to have it, no longer of any use to my life. Just a burden to my life. So the more sorting and organizing I begin to do in my being, slowly the muck from the subconscious, it keeps on resurfacing itself. Why? Because now you are ready to look at it. So I believe that it just happens kind of automatically once we are on the path, organically, more and more stuff appears in the being. So that I can become conscious of it. And once I become conscious of it, only then I can offer it to the sacrificial fire or to the mother or to the divine for transformation. So mother would say that, show me your darkest parts. You know, don't show me all the beauty you have. I know the beauty. Show me your darkest. Why show me your darkest? So that I can put my force and transform it. And what is mother's force? Mother's force is this eye of consciousness that we have. The moment I have an inner eye through which I look at myself and I look at my movements, my anger, my desires, my limitations, the more conscious I become of that, it's the mother's force working in me, which will make it possible for me to offer it in the fire and hence transform it. So even the stuff from the subconscious will be taken care of gradually, slowly.
Yeah.
And hence it refers to the purification that you were talking of in the earlier.
Yeah. Yes, because these are things, you know, like consciously, I understand so much, and I don't even have to understand, and I'm like there, you know, like in the present, and it is such a part of, you know, like grace. I do get it, but now what I'm facing is like few dreams that are recurrent, so I am working with that, and that to join those dots, you know, that why are they so recurrent? So that is where I feel the subconscious thing, you know, I think the divine is helping, I think.
So now that the dreams are resurfacing or presenting themselves, I think one way, again, there can be many, many ways. One way is to consciously keep on offering all of that, you know, consciously that, okay, mother, this is the dream and I offer this to you for whatever need it has arisen. Because we don't know why the dream has arisen. We don't know what are the dots that need to be resolved or connected. But only mother can point us or intuitively guide us towards whatever needs to be resolved. So I think this continuous offering of whatever I see in my room, that is such a easy key that mother has left us, you know, to us. Remember me and offer. Remember me and offer. Yes. So whatever I become aware of, I just keep on offering it to the mother.
Yes.
Yeah. Anything from you, Rashmi ji?
What actually really touches me is that every moment I have to shake off the past.
Mm.
Every moment.
Yeah.
And you know, in the earlier one, she was talking about that I should not commit no error. Here she is praying that even if mistakes happen in my life, I have to acknowledge that and rectify it. Okay, and I have to make them so powerless that they don't bring any consequences in my life. And what I have to do actually, I have to put my foot down firmly on all that. What are they? The ignorance, obscurity, egoism. I have to put down firmly which no longer should exist. So this ignorance, obscurity, egoism should not exist in my life. That is what, you know, that is the ultimate direction she is giving me. And I must take my flight boldly towards a wider horizon, an intenser light, with more perfect compassion and a love which is disinterested. That is a very fantastic word, actually, towards the master of our life.
Yeah.
That is what immediately came to my mind. Yeah.
Yeah. Disinterested love. Yeah. You know, usually when we approach the divine, we are full of our interests. So it's a very important word, disinterested love. So that now only Lord is enough, you know, only feet of the Lord is enough. Just this connection, communion with the divinity is enough. And there are no further interests that I want to fulfill through the divine presence. Since we are so used to kind of using everything as a means to an end. You know, why I need education? So that I can have a job. Okay, why do I need job? So that I can have a, you know, some money. Why do I need money? So that I can have a good family. So everything we use in our consumerist way as a means to an end. And when we approach the divine, we also approach the divine as a means to an end. That's how we approach. So it's beautiful if slowly, gradually, through our purification, all that I ask for is just this communion with the divine, and that is enough. That is enough. Yeah. Beautiful. Yeah, so I'll just kind of read through it again and see if there is anything that comes up. December 29, 1913. Oh Lord, so mother is talking about this convention of, you know, celebrating the end of an year and beginning of another new year. O Lord, grant that this collective convention of the ending year be for us also the occasion to put an end to a whole lot of bonds and attachments, illusions and weaknesses, which have no longer any purpose in our lives. You know, we do this Diwali ki safai. We do, when somebody is coming at our home, we do a safai, you know. Or even in day-to-day life, we may do this dusting and kind of sorting and organizing of our homes. Now, just as our material homes need the caretaking, our being also needs the caretaking. Each moment of my life, each moment, I think in Sikshantar, you know, Shweta is a teacher in Sikshantar school. There is this song that every moment we are born, every moment we are new. But the way we live life somehow, we are not really new every moment. The past haunts us badly. The past burdens us badly. And each moment then becomes just a rotten moment. We no really have anything new in any new moment. So the moment may be new, but I am the old one. It does not make a difference to me. So Mother is using the idea of this collective convention that celebrating a new year, that, you know, something new is coming, fresh, alive, shiny, full of possibilities. Can we also look at our each moment of our life full of new possibilities, full of new birth for me, not attaching much importance to the images I have about myself and trying to preserve those images. That's what we do as adults. But children, you know, I think we need to learn a lot from the children, that children are every moment, especially little ones, every moment they are new. Without even knowing about it, in oblivion, they are new. You know, as if that they shake off past like anything, in oblivion, in their innocence. So they may have gotten a hurt in, maybe yesterday they got hurt, but today they've forgotten about it. They may remind it, you know, oh my God, mommy, it's hurting. But it's not burdening on their head. But what happens with us adults due to our so-called developed minds, you know, we burden ourselves with all the past every new moment. And that's why we suck. You know, adults really become so boring and dull as we grow up. But while children are so full of life and aliveness and also new creativity and possibilities, you know, they can, and that's why older people, you know, elderly people, they love to be with children, because otherwise the life, adult life is very, very boring. But they want to be around little children, because little children make life really alive. They're full of new possibilities. So I think we need to learn from also our dusting of our homes that we do, that can I dust my own being? Whatever I was thinking yesterday or in the past moment, can I just drop it altogether? Just drop it. I do not have to think it that, oh, shall I drop it? Oh my God, it's so important. What was that person think about me? No calculation at all. Just like a child, can I just drop off the previous moment that happened? Because if I do not drop, then the being of love, that is my true nature, that becomes obscured, you know, that becomes shaded, that becomes as if I've masked the being of love. And that's why in our relationships, then we don't have enough love, because I'm burdened by what that person said to me yesterday, what I would say to him in future, all that burden is there. So it's a mask or a jacket that comes on my being of love. While children are full of love, why? Because they are not masked by these manipulations each moment. So can we also consciously, because we are adult, we have developed minds, can we have this possibility of consciously knowing that yes, something happened yesterday or in the past, but I don't want to be there. I want to be here freshly alive. Can I just drop it off? As if the person I'm meeting in front of me, who may be my spouse or my child, I'm meeting him for the first time. Totally new, without any baggage, because only then I can be alive. So that is our possibility. And I think we've already discussed learning through our mistakes, recognizing, first of all, noticing our mistakes, acknowledging them, and then having a yearning to rectify them, having a yearning to progress through them. and then the mistakes just appear like vain mirages, you know, that as if, were they really real? Because now you are able to shake off the past, like immediate, without any thinking or calculation. The moment you do that, the mistakes actually appear like vain mirages, as if they were really illusion or real. I don't really know. The lesson has been learned. You're fresh every moment now. And this has to be done every moment of our life. Yeah. I think we have already talked about this, that no longer should exist on all in ignorance, all obscurity, all egoism. May we take our flight boldly towards wider horizons, intenser light, more perfect compassion, and more disinterested love towards thee. And I think this can be actually a mantra, you know, that's shaking off the past like falling dust. It actually can be a mantra for our life. Little sutra that we can have as a tool. The moment something is burdening me, in that moment, since I want to love myself too much, I want to be kind to myself and others, can I just drop it off? In many moments, it may not be possible. But in those moments where it is possible, where I want to do it, can I just become full of love again by shaking off that dust, by dusting off my own self? I do a lot of dusting at home, but can I just dust off my own self also? Yeah. And this is a lifelong of a process of dusting that is required. I hail thee, O Lord, master of our life, and I want to proclaim thy reign over all the earth. And we cannot proclaim the divine reign on all over the earth if we keep on holding on to past every moment of our life. It's very simple. You know, if we can have this simplicity of just being new and fresh every moment. Less burden, more lightness, more aliveness. I think this is the biggest act of kindness that we can do to anybody else and also to our own self. Less of torture and more of kindness. Taking each moment as it comes, baby steps, fully alive, because we don't know what may happen next moment. We don't know whether we may be alive really next moment or not. So can I be fully here, alive and fresh? That is the biggest challenge that we have as adults. Yeah. Yeah. Anything more? Anyone? Okay, so I think then we can end it here, and thank you everyone for sharing, reflecting and contemplating. Yes, Kuldeep.
Thank you,
Shweta.
एक question है.
हाँ जी बताएं.
जो कुछ कुछ जो mental हमारे positions होते हैं या मतलब जो हमारी क्या बोलते हैं जो lingering feelings होती हैं. Restlessness वगैरह तो आप बोलते हो be with that restlessness तो आपका मतलब इतना है ना कि don't go for any distraction at that moment, right?
Yes, so Kuldeep ji, what I wanted to share through that is that imagine that these distractions are here, okay? Now you have followed them a lot, you have followed their dictates a lot, and you have suffered, okay? Now I am convinced that I should not be really following those distractions. Once I am convinced, then you can let those distractions be just like ripples around you, but have the courage not to follow them. That's what I mean by being with those distractions. So not being puppeted around by their dictates. Because they are...
What I mean, suppose you have a lingering feeling of restlessness.
Yeah.
And or the lingering feeling of boredom or sadness of your being, meaninglessness and all. So in that case, it becomes painful and we try to find some distraction for some relief.
Okay. I think I get it.
आप जो बोलते हैं ना, आप जब बोलते हैं, be with that restlessness, be with that boredom. I think you are just meaning that you don't look for any distractions.
Achha, I think so. One of
or the tools, or you mean something else?
One of the tools here in this context, Kuldeep ji, I would like to point out. See, imagine that I am an actor, एंड आई एम प्लेइंग अ रोल ऑफ अ मर्डरर, द मोमेंट आई फॉरगेट दैट आई एम एन एक्टर एंड नॉट रियली द मर्डरर इन द स्टोरी, द मोमेंट आई बिकम टू आइडेंटिफाइड विद द रोल ऑफ मर्डरर, आई विल रियली बिकम मिजरेबल. Okay, so in that moment of restlessness or misery or suffering, if in that moment, out of my understanding, now I can realize that I am just the actor and not these stories that heavy my being so much. In that moment of disidentification, the suffering comes to an end immediately.
Seriousness also is coming from holding on to that.
सीरियसनेस इज कमिंग बिकॉज आई एम आइडेंटिफाइंग टू मच विद द रोल आई प्ले. द मोमेंट आई स्टेप बैक and I see, okay, I am aware of the roles I play. Who I truly am is the light of awareness which looks at all these plays. There is no suffering. So the suffering is only a signal ki bhaiya phir se role ban gaye. Phir se identify kar liya role of murderer ke saath. So the moment I remind that I am the pure actor and not truly the role I play, although the role also is played by me, but I am more than the role I play. In that moment, suffering cannot be existing. Suffering cannot be. Suffering only exists when I am limiting myself by that little role that I play, the images I have about myself. Only there suffering can exist. So all that is needed is disidentification from the role.
Thank you, Monika ji.
Thank you. Yeah, thank you so much. Bye-bye, everyone. Thank you.